everything that happens today would somehow bring you worship. Be with us in this service. We thank you for what you're going to do. For it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Our call to worship this morning is taken from number 200 in your hymnal, number 200. And then for song service, we're going to sing 201 through 203, the verses marked by the arrows. And we'll have a little transition between them. Let's begin.
From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ.
Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love.
God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich.
Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved.
This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Amen.
Thank you.
it's in my pocket. I guess he's going to be really, really old. So Luke, remember your daddy has a birthday coming. Daddy's birthday is this week.
Oh, look at those eyes.
All right, very good. Moving right along. We want to let you know that we do have our evening fellowship hour tonight, but before that, we have our Hispanic services. And again, Joe and Lisa would love to have you come and join them sometime. But moving on, then, for our evening service, we've started a new video series by Dr. David Jeremiah entitled A.D. A lot of us are familiar with the story of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But what happened after that? How did we get to where we are now? And so this covers basically the first 11 chapters of the book of Acts. And it tells the story of the book of Acts. Very, very interesting, very enlightening, very inspirational. So that's tonight at 6 o'clock if you want to come and join us. Also want to remind you that it is Christmas in August. You'll notice there are Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes on the back bench. And if you'd like to take some of those home and start filling them up, we would love to have you do that. Then on Wednesdays and Thursdays, my peace and quiet has been invaded here at the church. All these ladies have been showing up to start working on shoeboxes downstairs in the fellowship room. So that's from 10 until 12. And Virginia would love to have as many come and join the party as you can. Also, we do have this coin jar up at the front. And again, we'll take more than just coins. The whole idea of this jar is to help with the shipping costs for Operation Christmas Child. And so that is what that is all about. By the way, you'll notice there is just a brief little notice in your bulletin about an unplanned expenditure that we had here at the church. The city of Walla Walla, in its infinite wisdom, decided we needed some backflow valves for our church irrigation system, and that started the whole process of us having to replace our control valves and basically have our system rebuilt. And we ended up with an $1,800 bill that was not budgeted, nor was it planned. And so if anybody would like to contribute to that, we would love to have you do so. I'll just put a note on it that says church irrigation system. It does not say Pastor's Coffee Fund. I'm sorry. All right. Moving right along, we do want to be praying for the peace of Jerusalem. A chilling little announcement. If you read in your bulletin, Pope Francis, who is the current pope, says that global warming is a fact and that a new global political authority is necessary in order to save humanity from utter disaster. In other words, he's saying we need a one world government. And so if you're familiar with Bible prophecy at all, if that doesn't just send a little chill down your spine, I don't know what will. And so we'll keep you posted on that. But the Pope is calling for a one world government to save us from ourselves. All right, as we move on to our mission moments time this morning, we are going to actually have something that comes through Crown College. Many of you know the Alliance has several educational institutions. One of them is in Minnesota. Believe it or not, some good things can come out of Minnesota other than mosquitoes. And that is Crown College. And anyway, listen to the presentation, and then we're going to ask Tex if he will lead us in prayer.
Being here at Crown College in St. Bonifacius, Minnesota has been a tremendous blessing.
One, two, three, four!
I'm the head baseball coach and head golf coach here at Crown College and love working with the college students. Getting an opportunity to not only coach, but mentor. But what I love about it is working with this next generation, to be able to see how eager they are, how hungry they are for the Word of God. It's amazing to see student-athletes stand up for Christ. And then what's great about it is when I step up and I say, Coach, can I pray for the team? Can I give a devotional? Growing up in Texas, baseball was my life. There were scouts that were actually talking to me about playing professionally. It was extremely exciting. to get that call, to get a scholarship to play at the Division I level. And then one day we were playing the University of Nebraska. It was opening weekend. I had just caught the day before, and this was the next morning, and I was in intense pain. My stomach was extended. I was just screaming out in pain. There was no way I was getting on the field. In fact, they rushed me to the hospital. They're trying to pump my stomach, so they're putting tubes down my nose to try to draw out anything that was blocking my stomach. If they didn't get my intestines unblocked, the intestines could rip and my body could go septic, and there was a 95% chance that I would die. I remember just asking them and just whispering out, almost out of agony, just please, just do something. Please help me, help my body. I need something. And that's when the blood transfusions actually took, and it ended up saving my life. Up taking out 30 inches of my intestines, literally reconnecting my body. When they sent the test away and they found out what happened to me, they diagnosed me with Crohn's disease. I've had times of doubt, to be very honest, asking God almost, where are you at times? When are you going to heal? When are you going to touch my body? Because now would be a good time. But I remember the Lord saying something to me I'll never forget. He said, Mike, if you just trust me, I have something much better for your life. Well, it's 2011, and I was meeting with a specialist with Crohn's disease, and he said, Mike, I have bad news. Your intestines show incredible amounts of Crohn's disease, just ravaging the intestines, and the best thing that we can do is to remove them. They said, we're going to have surgery, and we're going to have it very, very soon. I wanted to go to general counsel. It was a place that I had longed to go. I had been before. I felt so filled with God's presence there. And the doctor just looked at me like I was crazy. He said, travel? I don't even know if you're safe to even drive home by yourself. And his warning to me was, if your system goes bad, if you start to bleed, if something goes wrong, you've got to get to the hospital immediately. And something did go wrong. It was right probably in the middle of general counsel, and I began to work. So I went to this taxi driver, and I remember when I got into the taxi, I was really wrestling with a choice. Do I ask this guy to take me to the hospital, or do I ask him to take me to the prayer meeting at general counsel? And I remember talking to him and said, just get me to the convention center where this prayer meeting is going on. I've got to get there. And when I got there, it was a full house, and so I found an open seat towards the back. I sat down and just kind of slumped over. I remember hearing Fred Hartley at that exact moment. He said, I feel like we need to pray for people right next to us. I remember turning to the people next to me. It happened to be Todd and Debbie Adams. They knew they needed to pray for me right away. I remember Todd saying, Mike, would I be allowed to just go get my dad, Virgil Adams, to come pray for you? And I said, please, I'll take anybody to pray for me right now. These guys started putting their hands on my shoulder and on my back, and even one put his hand on my stomach. It was as if there's these bubbles that were just welling up inside of my body, and all of a sudden it was just this flushing of just cool water just kind of came over me. And the only thing I can describe it is from scripture where it says in the Psalms where it says the deep calls the deep, and these waterfalls kind of crash over me as if God's Spirit just flooded out onto my body and began to bring just a healing touch to me that I've never felt before. It was so great. I remember almost wanting to stop the guys and the ladies that almost mid-prayer said, I'm good, this is amazing, I've never felt this way. And tears were just flowing from my eyes. And I remember Virgil Adams coming up to me and giving me this huge hug. He said, Mike, God gave me a word for you. He said that God's going to give you manna from heaven every day. He's not going to give you more than you need, that it would just waste away, but he's going to give you exactly what you need. No matter how long it takes, no matter how far we've got to endure, that Christ endured far greater tragedies and far greater trial than we've ever gone through. Every moment, God, I will take that manna for today. I would take what you will give me today, and it's always sustained me, and it's always carried me. It's deepened our understanding and really our appreciation for time together. And so when our family gets time together, it's time I don't want to waste. Because I don't know if tomorrow's promised. It's actually a blessing in disguise that when we play together, when we hang out together, when we get time to be together, it's time that I'm so thankful for, and I'll never change it. I will endure. I will live. I will shout that Jesus is my Savior. He's also my healer. He's the one that provides for me. And now I realize that God did absolutely have a better plan for my life. I just trusted Him. This was the greatest decision I've ever made.
Four in on three. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Four in.
Good job, guys. Two more.
Dealing with in this morning, our Heavenly Father, it's good to see a family that shows where our attention should be directed. Too often we direct it to the human beings, but as we see in this family, where this coach doesn't want the praise to him, he wants the praise to thee, because you are the one that gave him the ability. You're the one that gave us all of the abilities to do what we can. In Jesus' name.
Father, we do thank you this morning that we can be here to lift up Jesus and praise Him. And Father, we do pray for the missionaries around the world. We may not be able to go around the world as missionaries, but at least, Father, we can be part of the missionary outreach by giving generously to the cause of the gospel. Bless this worship, each one of us, that we give joyfully for the cause of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.
The scripture for this morning is taken out of Peter, 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. It says, "For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ." Did you notice the first three words? "For you know." In other words, it's not a mystery, it's a revelation. We know it. And so, also it says, "It was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed."
In other words, we were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, and the price was like paying with the king's ransom. And so it was a redemption price so great that only God himself could pay it. But also notice, it says you were redeemed from the empty way of life. So you know that our past unregenerate life was vain, powerless, valueless, and worthless. And that's because a life without Christ is futile and useless. But the good news is that God's mercy is available to each one of us just for the asking. So this morning, if you would like to share a prayer need, we would like to pray for that.
This morning, we're listening to the chord on our old-time music. A lady called in and asked for everybody to pray for our firefighters, our family, and pray for some rain. But I also would like to continue prayer for my son and my daughter-in-law, Vernon Ellen. And he's still, and I talked to him today and said they're getting better. So thanks for the prayer.
Prayers again for Mark. His foot is definitely got a break in the arch of the, or in the top of the foot. And the doctor cast it saying that Mark's probably going to have surgery. He thinks the bones are too far apart to heal together. But I pray that those bones will heal and Mark won't need surgery.
I have a couple of coworkers that are having health issues. One is a young lady. She's got a problem with her thyroid, and the doctors are telling her she may not be able to have children because of this. And she's also got a problem with her blood sugar dropping. And another coworker found out she has breast cancer. They caught it in time, but the chemotherapy is really doing a number on her. Stacy Miller is the one with the thyroid and the blood sugar, and Elvira Jimenez has the breast cancer.
Now, most of you have been praying for baby Michael and his feeding issues. Justin and Sean have 3 appointments in Tri-Cities this week with him. And it turns out that the issue is not the formula, it's not the bottle, it's his jaw. His jaw is set back too far, and so they're going to be referred to Children's Hospital and see a jaw doctor. And so just pray that the doctor be wise and what needs to be done, because they said they're holding off on him being able to eat because they feel that it'll cause swallowing, choking issues with the way his jaw is.
I want to thank God that I could report to you that my brother went through surgery on Tuesday. He is recovering. This was a very hard surgery. They basically cut him in half. It took out an 8-pound tumor. It was cancerous, but the cancer seems to be contained within the tumor. So long pain. He's out of ICU as of Thursday evening. He may be released to go back to the motel tomorrow. He and his wife, my sister-in-law, are 4 hours away from home. Their home is to the north 4 hours, and their daughter lives 4 hours south. So my sister-in-law is there alone in the motel to help take care of him while he's at the hospital. So we pray for relief from pain, healing for my brother, and strength for my sister-in-law. I thank you very much. And my sister-in-law said thank you for praying for help.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. And Father, we do continue to pray for the firefighters. And Father, we just pray for for wisdom and understanding in these things as they fight fires. And Father, we just pray for the families that have been affected by the tragedy of the death of some of these firefighters. And Father, we just pray for intervention. Also, Father, we do continue to pray for Vern and Ellen, and be with them at this time and supply their needs. And also, Father, for Mark, for his food, that he will be able to recover from that without any surgery. And also, Father, we do pray for Elvira, that has breast cancer. We just pray for healing, be with her at this time. And Father, for the lady that has a thyroid problem, and we just pray, Father, also for the blood sugar that's out of control, and we just put them in your hands. Also, Father, we do pray for Michael, for his jaw situation, that the surgeons or the doctors will be able to treat that condition. And also, Father, for Lynn, that has had this surgery, and the tumor was removed, Father, and we just pray that you will take away this pain that he has. And also, Father, we also pray for any unspoken requests this morning. We put it before you. And as we listen to your word, speak to each one of us. And we thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you have your Bibles, please turn to John chapter 14. In the Gospel of John, it is Passion Week. It's Thursday night of Passion Week. The disciples have met with Jesus in the upper room in Jerusalem. Hundreds of thousands of people have arrived in Jerusalem for the Passover. During the Passover feast, Jesus has reinstituted the meaning of that supper. We now call it the Lord's Supper. He said that he was going to become the Lamb of God that would die for us. Now, 2 weeks ago, we took a look at one of Jesus' perhaps most politically incorrect statements, where he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." We talked about what that meant. Last week, we took a look at one of the most incredible statements that Jesus ever made, where he said that greater things you will do. Now, what were these greater things? Well, when we took a look at it, we decided there's no greater miracle than Jesus performed. Jesus literally healed people. He literally raised people from the dead. He actually raised from the dead after his crucifixion on the cross. So it's not that you and I can go out and perform great miracles, but remember we said that in context, Jesus is talking about his greater work, his greater ministry. And we saw that in the book of Acts, on the first day, when Peter, on the day of Pentecost, preached, over 3,000 were saved. And the gospel started to spread like wildfire. And we said that you and I can be a part of that greater work that Jesus is doing, reaching people around the world. And we mentioned, for those of you who are helping out with Operation Christmas Child, packing shoeboxes, that over 10 million shoeboxes have gone out. That is a greater work, as the gospel is going out through this very simple method. Well, now we're going to continue on with Jesus' discussion. And as we do so, let me just say that if a person is picked up by the police for questioning, the suspect, who knows he is innocent, is afraid to say the wrong thing. So he says, "I refuse to comment further until my attorney is present." End of questioning. The wise person knows he is above his head, and he needs someone to come alongside to help him. Well, I hope you're never in that position where you're being questioned by the police and you go, "Uh-oh, I need an attorney." But if you do, you know that there is someone you can call, someone who will stand beside you, someone who will represent you. Well, we're going to talk about that as we get into our key verse this morning. This morning we're going to be talking about the counselor, or if you have another version of the Bible, it may call him the helper. Another might call him the advocate. But we're going to call him the counselor this morning, because in John chapter 14, verse 16, it says this: "I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The point we want to make is simply this. Jesus will leave his disciples, but he is sending the counselor in his place. And as we go through this morning, the question that I need to ask myself is simply this. Do I sense the leading of the Holy Spirit in my life? We're going to see that that counselor, that helper, that advocate is the Holy Spirit of God. And he is being sent by Jesus to you and me for a reason. Do I sense his leading in my life? All right, this morning, there is simply going to be three words that we're going to focus in. Now, class, I want you to pay attention to these three words because there will be an exam afterwards. Now, I'm not going to tell you who, but you may be the person at the back door as I'm greeting people. And I ask, what were the three words? All right? Everybody's going to go out the side exit. I may follow you out the side exit and say, what were the three words? They're very simple because they all begin with the same letter. Command, counselor, and congruent. Command, counselor, and congruent. All right? And no cheating, no writing on the palm of your hand, so you would go. All right? First of all, command. In John chapter 14, verse 15, after Jesus has said these incredible things, greater things you will do, ask anything you ask in my name and I will do it, he goes on to say in John chapter 14, verse 15, if you love me, you will obey what I command. That's the first word, command. David Guzik says this, this is a fair measure of our love for Jesus. It is easy to think of loving Jesus in merely sentimental or emotional terms. It is wonderful when our love for Jesus has sentiment and passion, but it must always be connected to keeping his commandments, or it isn't love at all. I was thrilled with our singing this morning. I love those hymns. And I hope that when you were singing them, it made you appreciate what Christ has done for you. I hope you felt good. I hope that when you got done singing them, you were in love with Jesus. Well, that's all good, to leave this place feeling good. But true love for Jesus is following his commands. It's doing what he says. How can we say that we love him if we don't follow him, if we don't obey him, if we don't do what he asks us to do? And so as we get into this section here, it starts with this simple reminder, if you love me, you will obey what I command. But then we go to the second word. The first word was what? Command. The second word is counselor, again, with a C. John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. It's very interesting here that we actually see Jesus praying for his disciples, praying for the believers. And we need to remember that when he's praying here, he's not just praying for the 11 that were left in that upper room. Judas had already left to betray Jesus. He's not just praying for those 11. He's praying for you and me. How do we know that? Well, wait till we get to John chapter 17. Okay, we have proof. He's praying for you and for me. He is praying to the Father, and the Father will give you another counselor. Now, the ancient Greek word is parakletos. This means a person summoned to one's aid, and may refer to an advisor, a legal defender, a mediator, or an intercessor. You can actually take that word apart, parakletos. Para means alongside. Kletos has the idea of calling upon. So you're calling upon someone to come next to you to help you. So in those days, a lawyer was a paraclete. A lawyer was someone who would stand up before someone who was accused or had some sort of legal issue and would plead their case for them. That was the idea of a counselor. Now, the interesting thing is, Jesus says that he will ask the Father for another. The word another is the ancient Greek word allo, which means another of the same kind, not another of a different kind. Just as Jesus shows the nature of God, the Father, so the Holy Spirit, being another of the same kind, will show the nature of Jesus. So remember, Jesus has been saying over and over again, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The things I do are what the Father has asked me to do. The things I say are the things that the Father has asked me to say. Now he's saying, I must leave you, but I'm coming back. But in the meantime, I'm sending you another, and that another will be like Jesus. He is the counselor. Essentially, the Holy Spirit is sent to empower and help the believer live the Christian life. The greater work described in John chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, is impossible without the empowering described in John chapter 14, verses 15 through 18. Now, you might be one of these guys who loves tools. Okay, you might be one of these guys who loves power tools. So you like going to Home Depot, and you like walking through the section, and you keep trying to convince your wife that you really need this tool. You know that project that she has for you? Well, you can't get that done unless you have this tool. You need this tool. So she relents and you take it home. Well, it's fine, but it does you no good unless you take it out of the box. Well, you take it out of the box and you take it to your workshop or where you're working, but a power tool is absolutely no good without power. You've got to plug it in. You've got to turn it on. You know, you can have a wonderful power tool and you can just try moving it up and down by your hand all day long. You're not going to get very far. The whole idea of a power tool is it's plugged in, and when you turn on the switch, it receives power and the tool does the work. The greater things that Jesus has just talked about, who's asked us to do, are impossible in our own strength and our own power. That's why he's sending the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will empower us. Jesus will give the Holy Spirit that he, a person, not a thing, may abide in us permanently, not temporarily, as in the Old Testament. Every once in a while, you will come across a cult. And this cult will try to tell you their ideas. And almost all of the cults not only err in the person of whom Jesus Christ is, but in the person of the Holy Spirit. They take a look at the Holy Spirit as some thing, like an it. The Holy Spirit is not a thing, it's not an it. The Holy Spirit is the person of God himself. He will abide in us permanently, not temporarily. In Psalm 51, verse 11, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come upon an individual for a task, like the Holy Spirit came upon David in order to be the king of Israel. But in Psalm 51, 11, David says, "Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me." Remember King Saul, the first king of Israel, the Holy Spirit had come upon him, but when he sinned, the Holy Spirit left. David says, "Don't take your Holy Spirit from me." Jesus is saying, when the Comforter comes, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will come permanently to be with you. Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 18, "I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you." How will we realize that? When the Holy Spirit of God comes upon the church and empowers the church to be the people that he's asked us to be. All right, so three words this morning. The first word was what? Command. The second word is what? Counselor. The third word is congruent. You might say, what in the world are you talking about? Well, let's define it. Congruence means marked by harmony amongst parts. Marked by harmony amongst parts. You might say, well, what does that have to do with anything? Well, in John chapter 14, verse 21, it says this. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. So we have three agents here. We have the believer, we have God the Son, and we have God the Father. If a believer loves Jesus and follows his commands, he will be loved by the Father. And if he's loved by the Father, the Son will love him as well. So we have a triangle of love between the believer, the Son, and the Father. Now, I hope there are no math teachers. Oh my goodness, there is a math teacher. Glenda. All right. Glenda, you're going to have to plug your ears, because the last math class I took was in 1969. All right. And I was never very good at math. But triangles are congruent when all corresponding sides and interior angles are congruent. The triangles will have the same shape and size, but one may be a mirror image of the other. So there's a picture to put on the screen, okay? Now, what you think of this as being one big triangle are actually two triangles, okay? They are congruent because all of their angles are the same. Afterwards, Glenda can straighten you out on the whole thing. But the idea is this. The parts work together because they are the same. Jesus said, whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. Then it says, he who loves me will be loved by my Father. And then it says, and I too will love him and show myself to him. So you have this congruence of love. The believer loving Jesus by keeping his commands results in the Father loving the believer, and Jesus loves him too. And it all is proven not by feelings, not by emotions, but by obedience, by obeying his commands. So, there's three words that we've taken a look at this morning. Command, counselor, and congruent. Now, I want to give you an illustration. One of my favorite TV programs of the 90s was a fellow by the name of Matlock. About 2 years ago, I served on jury duty here in Walla Walla County, and as I was sitting in the jury box, the judge announced to us, if you've watched Matlock, that's not how it is in a real courtroom, all right? Have you ever noticed that Matlock's clients were all innocent? He didn't have guilty clients. And did you notice that he always got them off? And normally he got them off by when he was representing them in the courtroom, he would irritate the judge terribly. You know, Mr. Matlock, can you please come to the point? Well, just a minute, Your Honor, if you'll bear with me. But he would always get the guilty person on the stand and somehow trip them up. And they would end up either confessing that they had murdered this person or committed the crime, or they wouldn't say a word. And the judge would throw out the case. Now, I hope I'm never accused of anything. But if I was, I'd want somebody like Ben Matlock. Yeah, he was kind of irritating to the judge. In fact, a few episodes he even got thrown in jail, you know, for contempt of court. But he was on the side of his defendant. He believed in them. He was an advocate. He was a parakletos. He was a counselor. He was there to stand up for his client. His client was sitting there behind the table, not saying a word. He stood up, He represented him and he defended him. Remember what our key verse is? John chapter 14, verse 16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. Jesus will leave his disciples as the story goes along. He's going to die on the cross. He's going to be buried. He's going to rise again. And then when he's standing with them on the Mount of Olives, he's going to ascend. But he sends the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit becomes the counselor in Jesus' place. Another counselor. So the question that I need to ask myself is, do I sense the leading of the Holy Spirit in my life? Remember that greater work that Jesus wants us to be a part of? Remember, we need to be a part of that greater work because of that other statement he made. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So how can we do this greater work? It's because the Holy Spirit, the counsel he has sent, wants to work through us. But we have to be willing. We have to be available. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your love, and Father, we thank you for this ongoing story of Jesus' life, even on the last night that he was with his disciples before he went to the cross. And Father, we thank you for the promise of the Counselor. Father, help us to obey your commands because we love you. Help us to rely upon the Counselor. And Father, we pray that we would have a congruent relationship with you and the Son. That we will love you and you will love us and the Son will love us, and together we will be the people that you want us to be. Help us now, we pray, for it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. I wanted to conclude our service this morning with a rousing hymn, and so we are going to turn to Victory in Jesus. Mary, if you would come and play for us, it's number 473. The words are on the screen. Let's stand. And then if we can get the microphone over to Ben Vegas, we're going to go ahead and ask him to pronounce the benediction.
Do this, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.